And of course, my recording software crashes as I'm talking. But as you can see, my my storage is my storage is not very empty. my storage does not have much room left. It's kind of a mixed bag as it's boop boop type of situation. That's for all this. But yeah, it's there we go. Yeah. it's a bit all over the place because of the way I have to repair everything. But the if all of the episodes of Critical Role ended with Matt Mercer dancing like he does to that Lady Gaga song in season one of Critical Role, which I'm pretty sure is still on the Snuggle Lord's high score, so he probably still sees that whenever he looks at his Connect on the Just Dance 2, I think it was. I would definitely watch more of their Critical Role episodes all the way through instead of being stuck somewhere just past the airship. Let's see. They made it. They did the hunt. Yeah, I'm way behind on the seasons. I know. They're somewhere near the end of season two already, and I'm still stuck about a quarter way through season one, which is actually technically season like 1.5, because they had that whole section that was before where they started actually recording. I did look into it. There is definitely a lot that went on. There are a lot of things that people can find if they do enough research on the Critical Role series. However, the videos that had the artwork removed, I really don't understand why they would want the artwork removed, because it just means that their artwork is getting more advertisement. All they really should have done is just been able to say, like, look, from here on out, just be like, yo, this person did the artwork. They're not taking commissions, but, you know, mad thanks to them for doing the intro. And instead, the person, like, wanted to sue them or something. It's like, why would you do that? Why would you waste such a good thing? Because that's free advertising. That's sitting there going, hey, I, as an artist, did that. Check it out, everybody. You know? And that's really something that all artists should aspire to, is they should aspire to get their name out there and become famous while they're still alive. You don't want to become famous after you're dead, because after you're dead, you can't really enjoy it. You really want to be famous while you're alive. And some people don't think you can enjoy being famous, but there are things that you're able to do when you're famous that you're not able to do when you're, you know, not famous. For example, money. Dead giveaway. Compare my channel's earnings to Critical Role's earnings. I understand they're two different genres, but I could do that as well. It's just a matter of having the equipment. I would need to record it on my laptop. I would need to have my laptop able to be recording while I'm operating my campaign. I play on Roll20, so, you know, it's an option, but it's not something that's very viable to me. I try to make sure that my campaign is very, I can still record like 30 minutes. I was sitting here thinking I had, why am I opening Firefox? I didn't want Firefox. I was thinking I had a lot less time. But yeah, I could record my campaigns, but I don't have the hardware capability for it just yet. I would love to get the hardware capability. That's one of the things that I plan to do. I don't even know what that's about. But yeah, that's one of the things that I'd be able to do is I would be able to record my D&D campaigns. Baby turtles will drop scutes when they grow. You can use the scutes to make a helmet. But yeah, I would love to be able to record my D&D sessions and record my campaign, especially right now because I'm going through this whole endgame crisis where my characters are, my players are supposed to be figuring out what they need to do and how they want to go about it. Because if they don't, then they're going to find themselves definitely missing out on the rebirth sequence, which, by the way, I do have planned out. And because I know none of my players are watching this, I'm totally going to give all of the spoilers. And then once, I think in like three sessions, I'll tell them, like 3 sessions from now, I'll tell them, or no, I'll wait a whole month. So 4 sessions from now, I'll tell them, oh yeah, by the way, if you guys wanted spoilers on how the whole rebirth thing was going to go down, all you had to do was just watch my YouTube channel and you'd have had the whole lowdown on all of it. And you guys totally missed out. You could have known a month ago. And they'll be like, oh my god, are you serious? And I'll be like, totally. I will tell at least 2 of them about it, simply because I know they'll just never tell the others, because they're sneaky like that. They're little mischievous types like me, where they're just like, oh really? So you're telling me if I don't tell the others where you hit it, that you'll tell me about it? It's like, yeah. It's like, oh my, this is going to be good. It's like, yeah, it is. You bet it is. And it is. It will. It will be good. It's just a matter of I need to have my characters in the game die. I need to have my players die in the game in order to have their characters get reborn. Because the plan is that I will have a, what is it? A diva or a deva. I'll have a deva show up, and the deva will basically be of the personality type where they don't get paid enough. They will be sitting there and they'll say, hey, you know, I don't get paid enough for this. The gods simply forgot about you. They sent me down here to sort out anything that was overlooked. That is my entire job at the moment, is just fixing all of the stuff they missed, because what happened was the world ended. Your body was brought to a tomb. You were buried. You are currently in your tomb. The process of bringing you to the afterlife, yeah, they messed up. The gods messed up. So you're still dead, but you're not, like, dead. That being said, it's been, like, 100 years or more. Since you died, probably, because a lot of people died when everything kind of, well, went to hell. Like, a lot of bad things happened, and now a lot of things are dead,
and now you're here, and I'm here, and we're all here, and nobody's really happy to see each other because, well, simply put, everyone you know is dead. So you get a second chance at life, but everyone you know is dead. I'm sorry. And they'll be like, oh, well, that kind of sucks. What if I don't want to come back? Well, you don't have to. But, you know, if that's the case, let me know now, and I'll just go ahead and whisk you away to the afterlife, and you'll live the rest of your years out in the afterlife. You know, dead. like, if you really don't want to come back, that's fine, but, like, I don't get paid enough for this, and it's a lot of paperwork. Just having you die, since, you know, I went through all the trouble of going and tracking you down and finding out who all died, who didn't die, who was supposed to die, who really should have died, and who were they after when they were murdering everyone, and all this other stuff, and I just don't get paid enough, man, you know? And they'll be like, I can relate to that. That's basically my plan for how this is all going to go down. As for how well everything's going to stick to that plan, that remains yet to be seen. I know my players. They're not the type to stick to plans. But the plan is that the players will find themselves facing off against literally endless waves of enemies until they TPK. That's the plan. The plan is TPK, total party kill. In case you were curious about what TPK stood for, it stands for total party kill. It means everyone died. The plan of the TPK is to send endless waves of enemies at the party until the party is finally overwhelmed, and then the party will find themselves no longer able to continue fighting the endless hordes of enemies, meaning that they will ultimately perish because they just cannot sustain. It's an endless horde. That's the point. The result will be that, of course, the party dies, they get resurrected. Specifically, they're going for a reincarnation, which is a little bit different than just straight-up resurrection. A straight-up resurrection would mean that they get all of their stuff back, or at least they get all of their stats back. The party's levels are very, very drastically varied. They're very different from each other. I'm playing as a wizard, and the wizard that I'm playing as is level 10. I'm playing as the highest level character in the party, and I'm not supposed to be the highest level character in the party, so that's a problem. That's one thing that I will be fixing with the whole reincarnation scenario, as my character will no longer be the min-maxed wizard. Instead, my character will be playing a different race, and the characters will be allowed a little bit more leeway in what they're able to perform, what types of stunts they're able to pull off because of simply not being in the same era of time anymore. They'll be in a different era, from where they were previously. They won't have to worry about, you know, past crimes. They won't have to worry about, oh, well, you know, I was told never return to this city. Well, yeah, that was how many hundreds of years ago? It's the same situation Avatar Aang faced in the Avatar series, where he's sitting there going, oh, well, you know, I have all these friends. It's like, oh, where are these friends? Oh, well, they all died like 1,000 years ago or something, or 100 years ago. So, yeah, they're not around anymore. And it's like, oh, so who's going to, you know, help us out? Oh, well, I hadn't really thought that far. Like, I knew this guy, and I knew this guy, and I knew this guy, but, they're all dead. It's like, yeah. Yeah, there's that. This will also allow me to introduce, a different locale to the game. I'll be able to introduce a different location. I think I want to introduce a port town because I want my characters, I want my players to know that there are literally continents that they have never explored. Like, I've been expecting them to explore continents for quite a long time now, and they still have not explored any of the continents. So, I really want to introduce a new continent. Also, next episode, I plan to talk about my first D&D campaign. So, if my original GM, Steve, is watching from, you know, the Steve who worked at the Red Light Cafe that is sadly long since closed down. If you're watching, Steve, get a hold of me. Leave a comment. Tell me you're watching my videos, because I still have my character. I still have the sheet. I still have the Dragonus character sheet. Okay? More about them in the future. More about them next episode, I should say. But I still have Dragonus. I still have her character sheet. I still have all of that badassery that she is. She's a 3.5 edition character. Dungeons and Dragons 3.5. 3.5e or 3.5 edition. There was some homebrew, but it was not much. Mostly it was one homebrew spell, I think, and then just a lot of custom enemies with very little amounts of experience given. And I mean comically little. I was killing flagship galleons with like anti-dragon ballistas on them, and I got like 10 experience per kill. So it was nuts. It was a wonderful campaign. It was the most fun I've had in any D&D campaign, and I really want to get back to campaigns like that again. Because that's the type of campaign that I want to play in, is one where people just pay attention to each other, you know? None of this online-only nonsense where it's lacking that special interaction of the GM and the player and the attention to detail and the bringing the focus to the task at hand, as opposed to the overarching story, because it's the player that is the real storyteller, whereas the GM is the narrator. If you ever really want to get into D&D, that's the best way to describe it, is the player is the storyteller. The GM is the narrator. So you can't really control what the narrator says, but you can control what the player says. And you can sit there and go, okay, well, my guy would do this, and the GM would narrate what happens next. You know, okay, let's say Skank McGank casts, you know, clone and decides to make himself a younger version and then sets up a massive trap. You know, that's actually a YouTube video of the animated spellbook. So, like, he would say, I want to do that. And then the GM would say, okay, well, this happens, and then this happens, and then this happens. And they'd go through the process of everything that unfolds. Dragonus ended up with a comically oversized amount of power for their level. They are level 3. The GM, Steve, told us, here's the deal. Every time I have a campaign with any of you guys, okay, you guys always end up becoming these superpowered gods by the time you're level 20, and I'm sick and tired of it, okay? This time, I have a real simple outline of a goal. I'm going to try and kill your characters. Just point blank, I'm going to try and murder your characters. Okay. And we were like, okay, yeah, whatever, fine. You know, it was my first campaign, so I had no idea what was going on. But he was like, yeah, okay, you know, you agree to it now, but wait until you see what I've got up my sleeve. 3 sessions later, he had facepalmed so many times that he was giving me his dice to roll because he could not believe, he couldn't fathom how I was rolling so well, despite having only asked just a few sessions prior, what does it mean when I roll a 20 on my very first ever combat attack against a dragon? A shadow dragon, I think it was, or a void dragon, I forget which, but it was a 20d20 breath attack of void dragon breath, and it was going to wipe out the party. It was going to be a TPK, except for me, who could have just easily turned around and went like, oh, this isn't the bathroom, I'll just go back into this treasure room over here and cower. And one of them was like, I swear to God, if you abandon us here, if you ditch us, I will haunt you. I'm like, ah, shit. Okay, so my character's young enough that they wouldn't know whether or not that's possible, so they'll just rather not risk it. So yeah, they ended up helping everyone. And they saved the party with a single attack on the first hit, TPK avoided, saved the party, killed the dragon, and it was awesome, and I loved it, okay? For my very first attack roll ever in a D&D game, I one-shot a dragon, and that's coming up next episode. So stay tuned for that, because that's going to be an amazing story. Because it gets so much worse, and yet so much better. Depending on which end of the spectrum you're viewing that all from. But in the meantime, stay safe. Remember, tune in tomorrow, because that's when that episode's going to air. If you're watching this at a later point in time, then it'll probably be up next. You're probably watching this in the playlist. Thank you for watching. Stay safe. Remember to like the video, comment on the video, subscribe to my channel. Liking all my videos will, of course, help my channel immensely. Watching lots of my videos will also help. Watching my videos for extended periods of time, giving my videos more time that you view it. YouTube keeps track of a lot of different aspects of the logistics of the videos, so just everything you can do will help. I also have a Patreon page. There's information listed on my YouTube profile in the About section. So remember to check that out. And in the meantime, till next time, stay safe.